Well, welcome to This Week at CBN, where I'm going to talk about next week, and specifically December 21st, 2012, and why so many people are now wondering, is the world going to end because the Mayan calendar is running out on December 21st, 2012? Well, predictions about the end of the world, they've been going on for centuries. You go back in time, and there was a pope who took a bunch of Christians to a mountain in Italy in AD 1000. He did that on January 1, AD 1000, saying, this has to be the day when Jesus comes back. But it wasn't. And so if you hear someone predicting the end of the world, should you be concerned? And should you be specifically concerned about what the Mayas are talking about? Well, what exactly did the Mayas believe? And how did they come up with the doomsday date of December 21st? Watch. For 1,300 years, Tikal was the heart of the Mayan civilization. It was called the City of Voices. In their temples, priests performed sacrifices and studied the stars. And some believe they predicted the end of the world. The Mayan long count calendar is even more accurate than our own. But it says that on December 21st, 2012, the long count of time will revert to zero.
During the classic period, they made a series of inscriptions in stone. They mention the beginning and the end of this era, but they don't say anything further about what will happen. Some people believe this 5,125-year cycle will end catastrophically, that it will be the end of the world as we know it.
The Mayas believed their lives depended on observing the sky and predicting the future.
They relied on the corn harvest to subsist, so they needed to know how the future, rainy seasons and the weather in general, would affect their crops.
It was also very important to the Mayas to get the attention of their gods. They wanted their acknowledgement and their blessing for a better future.
To get the attention of their gods and ancestors, the early Mayas sacrificed blood, their own blood.
They believed that gods actually created man from corn. To bring that corn to life, the gods had to sacrifice their own blood. The Mayans felt indebted to them and gave their blood in return.
In their efforts to get closer to the gods, Mayas went into long periods of fasting and isolation. But they could only enter into the presence of God after extreme self-sacrifice. Sandstone carvings show the rituals performed in Mayan vision ceremonies with a stingray spine. A woman pierces her tongue. The more painful the ritual, the more valuable the blood.
We believe they drank some sort of intoxicating substance and then performed these rituals. The pain itself was very important. So through this hole in the tongue, they ran a cord, sometimes laced with thorns and obsidian blades. Then they collected the blood on scrolls, which they burned. The smoke and the blood rose into the sky to the gods.
From the burning scrolls rises the image of a serpent, and perhaps an ancestor, god or ancient king. But the vision is elusive. Carved into this stone is the Mayan glyph for conjure. It consists of a hand grasping a fish. To the Mayas, seeing a vision is like reaching into a flowing stream to catch a fish. Hard to control and easy to lose.
If we read it literally, it only says conjure. It doesn't even say vision. After all of her suffering, this doesn't necessarily say she was successful in seeing anything.
During the early years of the Mayan civilization, even kings performed these painful rituals, desperately seeking the gods on behalf of their people. Over the centuries, the great Mayan Empire crumbled, and their cities and temples were abandoned, and lost in the jungle. Still, remnants of the culture remained.
There was a blending of cultures from Mexico and the Mayan territories. It seems there was a moment when a divine thirst for blood sprung up.
In the 16th century, Spanish monk Diego de Landa wrote of witnessing Mayan priests trying to reach God by sacrificing captives.
They hurt him with great skill and cruelty, cutting him with a knife between the ribs on the left side. The priest reached into his chest and grabbed his heart like a rapid tiger, snatching it. Then they put his heart on a plate.
Many of the ancient rituals died with the priests, who were killed by Spanish soldiers in what came to be known as the Mexican Inquisition. But their culture didn't completely disappear. Gilberto Chayax is a modern Mayan priest.
What we're doing with the ceremonies, with the sacred fire, is asking God to give us his blessing, to teach us how to live well, to bring peace to our countries, and to bless our families. We conjure him so he can speak to us through the fire.
To this day, descendants of the Mayas still practice many ancient traditions. They offer sacrifices and conjure visions, all in hopes of pleasing the gods and catching an elusive glimpse of eternity. Well, every time I see the religious practices of other cultures, I'm very grateful for the gospel. Realize that Christianity is the only religion that God comes to you. And he comes to you not expecting anything, but saying, I love you. I want to forgive you. I want to redeem you. I want to establish my covenant with you. And it's a covenant made in the blood of Jesus Christ. We didn't come up with it. We didn't come up with salvation. God did. And he gives it to us freely. We don't have to please him. We don't have to sacrifice for him. We just have to love him, and we just have to love one another. But let's talk about December 21st, and specifically, what does the Bible say about these kinds of end-time predictions where people come out with, I know the day, it's going to happen on such and such a day, and whether it's some group that thinks a comet going by means the end of the world, or some group that says because the Mayan long count calendar is being reset to zero, that means the world's going to end on a such and such a day. Well, here are the words of Jesus, and you can trust them. They come from Matthew 24, verse 36. Of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. And when you start understanding only God the Father knows, and he, in his wisdom, has decided not to reveal that date, not even to the angels, not even to Jesus. Jesus didn't know. So if for someone to predict a particular date, when you hear that, automatically reject it. It's not going to happen, and it's not going to happen on December 21st. Now, what is the sign of Jesus' coming? Well, he was very specific about that. And I think there's a lot of confusion in the Christian church today over, are we in the last days? What are the signs? What should we be looking for? And there's a lot of sort of pseudo-interpretation, if you will, of the various signs. And boy, in my lifetime, I've seen so many different predictions and who was the Antichrist and all these kinds of things. Don't get confused with that either, and don't get caught up in it, because it gets you off the track of what Jesus has clearly commanded us to do, which is go and preach the gospel and go and make disciples. He didn't say go and peer into these things. In fact, he's very specific. No one knows the hour and day, so we shouldn't be wasting our time trying to find that. We should be putting our time to good use. We should be redeeming the time and making disciples and telling people the good news. God wants to come to you. You don't have to please him. You don't have to do these weird sacrifices. He wants to come to you, and he wants to forgive you and cleanse you and make you new again. That's what we need to be about. Well, here's the sign. It's from the same chapter in Matthew, Matthew 24, verses 29 through 31. Immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Now, that's a real specific sign. And that's what Jesus says. When you see this, that means the end is very near. So ask yourself this. Has the sun come up today? Did the moon shine last night? Are the stars falling from heaven? Well, if those things have not been shaken, then you can have assurance that the end of the world is not here. And when you look at those specific signs, the world is going to panic. In fact, the Bible says specifically, men's hearts will fail them for fear. There'll be such a fear that grips them that literally their hearts will stop beating because of what is getting ready to happen. Can you imagine a day when you wake up and the sun isn't shining and stars are falling and things are moving and the powers of the heavens are shaken? That will be quite a day. And Jesus says we should rejoice at that, that we should be starting to look because our redemption draws nigh. The Son of Man will appear in heaven. Then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they will gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. So when you see these signs, don't panic. Don't be worried. Look to the heavens, for your redemption draws nigh. The angels will come to gather you so that you can be with Jesus for all eternity. And that will be a great day. Well, that's it for this week at CBN. God bless you.